intentionally hide behind those two initials? Phyllis for P. What is the D for?
Dorothy.
Phyllis Dorothy. Yes. Did you want to be considered as a man or just as an asexual figure?
Well, at the time, and I can remember this very clearly, Elaine, I was wondering, you know, what name shall I write under? Of course, I didn't know then I was going to get the book accepted. And I wrote down Phyllis D. James, Phyllis James, P.D. James. I wasn't really very fond of my Christian name. I suppose if I'd had an exciting Christian name like Hermione James or Veronica James, I might have chosen differently. I thought P.D. James looks rather pleasant. Perhaps subconsciously, I thought that as I'm going to be a mystery writer, let's begin with a bit of mystery. But quite honestly, I don't think I was deliberately trying to deceive anyone about my sex.
Now, that all happened 20 years ago. Is that right?
Yes, yes.
The first book?
Absolutely,
now,
yes, 20 years ago.
Why did you start?
Well, I knew from a very early age indeed that I wanted to be a novelist. I was a very late beginner, I'm afraid. All sorts of excuses. The natural indolence that some of we writers have, being 19 when the war broke out, being bombed, early marriage, children, all sorts of excuses.
But one writer said you took it up in your spare time.
Oh, dear, little spare time. I was working full-time to support my family, and I did it early in the morning. But I do remember feeling, you know, it's no good. It's all very difficult. But if I don't begin, then eventually I'm going to be a grandmother saying to my grandchildren, of course, my dears, I really always wanted to be a writer. And that would be a dreadful failure.
You say you were supporting your family. Why was that? Were you a one-parent family of some kind?
Well, my dear husband came back from the war. He was a doctor in the Royal Army Medical Corps, mentally ill, so that, in fact, I had to support him and my two daughters.
So it began out of a kind of desperation, did it?
Yes, it didn't begin, you know, out of the need to make some extra money, although, of course, the extra money was jolly useful. I didn't somehow see the books were going to. It was a psychological need to be a writer. I'm not a nurse,
that's another
I'm not a doctor.
That's another illusion that seems
yes.
to be widespread,
yes.
that you were a forensic scientist. You weren't.
No,
but,
no.
But you were in the Home Office as what?
Yes, I was working in the Home Office as a principal, and the division I worked in was responsible for the administration of the Forensic Science Service. So obviously I got to know how a forensic laboratory is administered and the kind of work that the forensic scientists do.
So you, like a good housekeeper, you used every morsel of knowledge in your first novels that you'd have
That was fairly well on, actually, in the number of novels, but you're absolutely right. I think a writer does, you know, use every morsel. And sometimes the morsels are stored away at the back of the mind. I know with the Shroud for a Nightingale, you know, where the nurse is killed by swallowing this tube and the disinfectant. I thought of that in the war when I was a Red Cross nurse for a short time, but it must have been 15 years, 16 years later before. No, more than that, before I used it.
Now, you have achieved, particularly, it seems to me, in the last, almost just the last 6 months, this enormous success, particularly in America. Yes. And people used to say somebody has achieved success. Now they say, how does one survive success? Isn't success lovely?
You know, I think it's totally dishonest to pretend that it isn't a great deal pleasanter to be successful than to be unsuccessful. And I actually believe, Elaine, it's better for the character. But I think it may be helpful to have it, you know, I mean, I'm a grandmother now. And maybe it's easier to take when you're a grandmother, because by the time you're over 60, you should know what values are important to you. You don't get deceived
you're over
by
60?
Your own propaganda. Oh, yes. Yes, 63 this year. Oh, yes. And you should by then be able to take success. So perhaps, although it would have been lovely if it had come when my husband was alive, perhaps, you know, it's better that it's come now.
Can we talk about the whole process of writing and reading? And I realize I've been saying crime novels. In fact, you write novels of detection.
From a mysterious death, a closed circle of suspects, you know, the detective, amateur or professional, and a solution which the reader must be able to arrive at by studying the clues.
Why are women accepted, I think, as mistresses of this particular genre, of the detective novel? Agatha Christie, Sayers, Marjorie Allingham, yourself.
Yeah.
Now you are called the Queen of Crime.
Yes.
You were the princess 10 years ago. and you've taken over Christie's crown, I suppose.
If I had Christie's sales, Elaine, I'm sure my publisher would be absolutely delighted.
But still, what is it in women's minds, a women's approach to the way life is lived and the way life is died that makes them so successful?
Well, I suppose an eye for detail, because so much clue-making depends on detail. You know, who prepared the poison canopy, who left the study door open, who wore that mysterious shade of lipstick. Certainly an eye for detail. A concern, I think, with human beings and their motives. We're much more concerned with feelings than we are with weaponry. It may be, you know, that the sort of... the general premise of the novel, that murder is a unique crime, uniquely wicked, and that however unpleasant you may be, you still have a right to live your life to the last moment. I think that good order, good social order, good moral order, good psychological order, are very important to we women. After all, we're the ones who bear the children. It is important to us. And this is a very ordered genre, isn't it?
Do you think that's what the readers look for, then?
I think it could be.
Are they looking for safety? Are they looking for assurance?
I think they are.
I mean, I'm looking for the excitement of the puzzle, I must admit. I've never realized that I was reading a morality tale.
You may be one of those rather rare readers who really do try and solve the puzzle, Elaine. I think you're in the minority.
I get angry.
And you look for the clues. Mm. This is a wonderfully logical way of looking at it. I'm not sure that many readers do bother very much. I mean, they have the back of their mind, well, I wonder who did it, but I'm not sure that, you know, we plant our clues so carefully, and
yes,
I wonder how many of them
painted windows
are picked up, you know. I think there is a great need for the reassurance. I mean, however difficult, you see, the reader's life may be, you know, at least he's not the corpse on the drawing room floor. And however guilty we all feel, and we all do feel guilty about something because it's part of the human condition, you know, at least when the detective says right, we know we can say, you know, I didn't do it. Please, it wasn't me.
And is it, I suppose it is also the illusion of violence, of sudden death, of brutality, without the reality that we've been hearing about earlier in the program.
Yes.
I mean, do you worry that you're giving a very shallow, perhaps dangerous image of what real violence is like?
Now, this is a very interesting and a very difficult question. Yes, I mean, I think some of the people criticizing the genre can say that what I'm doing is trivializing it, making it into some kind of puzzle. The reality of violent death. Now, I think that could be a legitimate criticism. And although in my books I do try to deal with death realistically, as in, you know, the passage that you read out, Elaine, I sometimes ask myself, how realistically, really am I treating it? My police work, I want the reader to feel this is how those policemen would have thought and acted and questioned and behaved and arrived at their conclusion. But it can't really be lifelike, can it? I think you see that with fictional detectives, we're all changing, rather. If I look back to the books I read when I was a girl, I mean, no policeman was ever touched with corruption. They were always the great good guys. And the way in which they questioned the suspects, well, nothing more gentlemanly could ever be imagined. And, as you know, one thinks of them as rather touching the forelock.
Yes,
are not like that.
And yet, throughout all those years, say over the last 60 years, one thing has remained the same in detective fiction. It's remained middle class, hasn't it?
Absolutely. It has, hasn't it? It has. Some people would say it has remain somewhat snobbish.
Does that mean that there are middle-class readers, or just that the actual background that you choose to write about?
Yes, I have. I certainly have characters who are not middle-class, and I really dislike categorizing any character and saying they're working-class, they're middle-class, but nevertheless, I know exactly what you mean, and I think the readership is basically middle-class. I think it's a genre that does basically appeal to the middle class.
Tell me about your working methods, because when you were explaining about your charts and how you attack them, I couldn't quite believe it. I mean, I believe the charts, so first explain those.
Well, of course, everything has to be planned in advance before the writing begins. I mean, it's obvious that I have to know who's going to be killed and where and when and why and by whom, and roughly, you know, how, in fact, the detective is going to solve the crime. And it's important to have it all down in black and white, especially on the actual day of the murder, so that I know exactly where everyone is at that particular time. And because I can... and in fact need to plan it so precisely, this does mean that I don't have to write it by beginning at the beginning and going right through to the end. In fact, I never have written a book that way. I write it rather as if I'm shooting a film. I mean, I've never shot a film, but I imagine it's rather like that. I think of it in scenes, so that if I'm feeling like writing dialogue, I can write dialogue. If I'm thinking of writing action, if I want to write the passage describing the finding of the body, I can do it. And then in the end, it's all pieced together, you know, rather like a jigsaw, really, I suppose.
So is it really a question of waking up and saying, I feel in rather depressed today, or I'm in a sunny mood? Which chapter would fit my mood? Is it?
Yes, I don't... I mean, perhaps it's a little more subconscious than that. You wake up and you go to the typewriter and find almost that you are doing one particular part. But certainly, if I have to do research particularly, and... I think in Innocent Blood there's one scene set in the Rose Garden in Regent's Park. And it was on a lovely, sunny Sunday morning, and I thought, I'll go and look at those roses. I'll go and see what the effect of the Rose Garden is on me, and then come back and write that scene.
Obviously, you must do a lot of research, and I don't mean book research about which poison would kill in 2 hours. Mm. You must walk the back streets, you must take tube trains, do you? With a notebook at hand? What is one of those research days like for you? Is it exciting or just hard work?
It's exciting. I like it. I enjoy the research. I find, though, that it takes up a tremendous amount of time. The writing is quicker, really, than all the months of preparing and thinking. Yes, it's marvellous. You go about and look at people, look at faces. Mm. Some faces are absolutely marvellous. You may not need them for a chief character, but
just,
you know...
the background feeling. Yes. Because the actual geographic location for any detective writer is important. You like the enclosed, not quite the locked room, though you've had locked rooms, haven't you?
Yes.
But the isolated island or the hospital.
Yes.
The forensic lab with its locked doors.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
What do you think of a television studio? We have security men, you're checked in, you're checked out. Would it make
yes.
it
good? Oh, indeed it would, Elaine. It would be marvellous. Because, as you say, it's secure. People can't walk in and out. Then there are a variety of people working here, and there's a great deal of talent about, and I suspect there's a great deal of ambition. And talented and ambitious people often do make enemies. There's a kind of hierarchy. And then you can get interesting people coming in from inside. Yes, and there's a great deal of technical knowledge. One would have to get that right, you know. You'd have to be in and really get the whole feel of it so that it was...
Well, who's the body on the studio floor or in dressing room 6?
Well, at a quick thought, I think I'd have somebody coming in from outside being interviewed. I'd have this kind of situation we've got, only I'd have a small table here and I'd have water, you see. And perhaps I'd have this politician or someone who might be going to say something terribly indiscreet that someone doesn't want him to say. And then he'd just take his drink of water.
And then? And then
you see, you die in front of 3.5 million people. Very exciting.
Soon to be read by 3.5 million people. I want to thank you very much, P.D. James.